Gentlemen, let's begin with a very simple thought process. I'm sure you guys have ideas on how to begin, how to kickstart, how to create an IP. And let's take a minute each to first express what you wanted to anyway say. And then I have a barrage of questions for you, and I'm sure a lot of people will have a lot of things to ask you as well. So shall we begin with you, Oum?
Sure. Good that we never got to meet before you got delayed before coming in, so we'll just go free-falling. Yeah. IP as a word or as a term is something that I didn't know when I started in 1995, and that's when I started my first IP. So as an organization that's based out of a little village called Bangalore in down south, okay. Nobody knew anything about it. There was no television invasion at that point in time, as just as much as it is today. So at that point in time, we started something, and kickstarting an IP has nothing to do with the plan, and I mean, it's, at least the way I know it, it's about the passion. It's about romancing the risk, as Mr. Velumani has said just a few minutes ago, and that's what we did. And that's what we found a lot of success in doing for about 12 years, consistently, year after year, doing something different. The property that we created was based on a theme called Hollywood, where it kept it was highly marketable, scalable, and sustainable. Now, that's how it began, and then I think we've seen a great deal of success financially, from a brand building point of view and everything else. And just to stay relevant with the audiences and brands, we have created something new called Wonderwall.
Okay.
Last year in Goa, a very dear friend of mine called Shailesh and Nikhil Chinappa and myself, we started a property called Wonderwall, and we'll talk about it in a bit. And the other interesting thing, the third part that we've started doing is creating IPs for government. So that's a very interesting thing where competition becomes irrelevant, you know. So we'll talk about it as we keep discussing.
Talk about
right?
That as well. That's that. Shoven, if we may hear from you. EVC and whatnot.
I'm the founder of a festival called Enchanted Valley Carnival. It's a four-year festival now. It happens in Ambi Valley City on the third weekend of December. EVC, I mean, in case you guys don't know, it's a multi-genre music and camping festival. We started in 2013. The main idea of starting this festival was to give the audience of India a little more than, you know, just a concert feeling which you get at the festivals, in the various festivals and concerts happening in India. So our main focus of the festival is three elements, that is music, camping and adventure. We were in fact the first camping festival to start camping on a very large scale. By very large scale, I mean we started off with 400 campers, of course, and we are strong 5,000 campers last year. In 2015, we were half bought by Universal Music, so now we are co-partners with Universal Music. Us and Twisted Entertainment, that's a founding company, we run the company together. Also, in last year, which was 2016, we decided to go multi-genre, is when we had like a massive stage of Bollywood artists like Arijit Singh, Farhan Badshah. At the same time, we also have artists like Martin Garrix, David Guetta, Tiësto. So it's probably one of the only multi-genre music camping festival in India.
Shoven, coming back to what does it take, you think, to kickstart an IP like you did?
I think it firstly takes a lot of money. Yeah, sure. To kickstart a
sure
festival.
It
yeah, it's a big either industry, which I mean I'm not from the event industry. I've actually studied finance. I did real estate. My association with Ambi Valley is very long. So I've been doing real estate for Ambi Valley. I have no idea how to. I had no idea to do how. I was passionate about music.
Okay.
I had no idea how to do an event. So when I started off, I was clueless. I had partners with me. I had friends with me who helped me do the festival. But it's very challenging. The industry is very challenging. Currently, there is a lot of competition in the market. So I think one of the key things of starting an IP is you need to be very careful with the amount of money you're spending to build the IP. When you end up spending too much money for the IP, you reach a stage where you're not able to kind of recover the money and you can kind of get lost. So I think that's something which I've learned is today, in today's market, you have to be very, very careful.
Great. Varun, my old friend, tell me, you come from a very different background. You come from you're a CEO at a television network and a famous one at that. How do you see IPs fitting in scheme of things for you? And of course, how do you think they should be kickstarted? How do you think they should be fueled?
Hi, everybody. Manish, I look at it in two different ways, you know. We wear two hats as an ITV network group.
Okay.
One, of course, we have our individual IPs, which is more from the India News or a NewsX perspective, which goes on and on year on year, which is more a B2C or a B2B communication that we do. But one thing more that we have learned the last 3 years when we were contemplating on where to go a step forward, did we realize that one thing which unites the nation beyond Pakistan is sports, and sports minus cricket. So we came out with this brilliant concept of Pro Wrestling League, which we brought the Indian amateur Olympic wrestlers to the fold. And last 2 years have been one of the most successful experiences of our life.
Okay.
So idea is one, I 100% agree, backed by finances is another one. But the third, which is the most important thing, is there has to be a story which could be sold, and the people who take it forward have to be made profitable. Then only these IPs will go long and be more bigger than what it is today.
Interesting that you talked about the idea and, more importantly, the whole storytelling aspect and whether there is a story out there to be told. Shoven, I'll begin with you with the question that I have. You spoke about money. I have often now experienced, and I may be wrong, but that's my experience, that IPs are often first created here in the heart rather than the head before they find the hands and legs. So is it a correct approach at all? And you talked about money, that's why I asked you this question.
The reason I started IP is for the passion of music.
Right.
I've been traveling everywhere in the world, been to almost every festival. That's the reason, I decided to do the IP, the whole. But at the same time, it does start from the heart, but it needs to be, you just can't do an IP from the heart because you want to do it. At the end of it, it becomes a business. So you need to have the right people with you. You need to have the right sponsors, the right partners. Of course, you need to have a vision. You need to have a plan, and you need to have a story. As you rightly said, story is very important for an IP.
Okay. And Oum, did you have any other view than this on kickstarting an IP? Is it more a heart issue, or is it more a head issue, or both?
It's a heart issue.
It is a heart issue.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Because everything else will follow you. Brands will come. Everything will come. Like, again, the kind of the pearls of wisdom that Mr. Velumani gave is incredible. Because, he says, if you have a job, make it good. If you have whatever, except for the wife, make everything good. So the question is, if you feel the vibe is going to be good, you would like to experience what you are trying to create, you can't go wrong. There are three stakeholders. You've got the audiences, you've got yourself, and you've got the partners, the sponsors. If all three stakeholders are going to be extremely happy with the outcome, you can't go wrong with it. And you design it in a way that it'll make a difference, right? One of the examples is, there's always a perception that the government, for instance, is not very open to interesting IPs, so to speak, right? But if you are lucky enough to be in the right place at the right time and work with the right stakeholders, you can make a difference not just to the audiences who are going to be coming, it's to the entire community. For instance, we've created a new IP called the Bengaluru Habba, Nama Bengaluru Habba, which means it's our Bangalore festival. We're rebranding the city. We are in the process redoing the infrastructure at each of these places that we're doing an event in. So if I'm going to be doing a festival at a lake, I ensure that all stakeholders redo the whole embankment and the infrastructure and everything else, so people of the city feel proud of the whole thing. Once you fix it, you're spending crores of rupees, you create a festival. And then that becomes a sustainable aspect. Then you go to heritage sites, create festivals. Go to beautiful parks. Go to streets. Go to every other place and create a festival where you are making a difference to the city, to the community, and the brands who are going to be associated are super pleased with the whole thing. That's just one successful model that we've created. Yeah.
So, if it is so driven by heart, do the Excel sheets happen at all?
Excel sheets will happen. You've got to stay in it for the long run. I've seen it happening twice over successfully. And I find myself really lucky to have gone through the phase where the first time around when we started, the first edition was a break even. Second and third, we lost very heavily. But the fourth onwards, there was no looking back. It kept multiplying. Because if you know you're going to give the right variant, you're going to keep adding value to what you're giving as an experience, and the vibe is perfect, you don't need to recreate what someone else has created. You create what you want to create. And you can't go wrong with it. And the Excel sheet finally comes, it works out. It always does. I can't give you a formula as to how it can work out, but it does work out.
So is Excel sheet is normally a break to the entire thing, or is it is it additive to the process normally for you?
You know, you need to have a plan for sure, right? Is that the question? I mean, are you saying?
I'm just saying that is an Excel sheet. When you think of the Excel sheet, is normally a process of which breaks a creative thought, or it actually adds on to it in your mind?
No, it has nothing to do with our creative thought process.
Okay.
The Excel sheets at all. You first create the idea, love it, and then you put the Excel sheet. The rest of them is the periphery. The core of it is something else, and the fluff is everything else. And it adds up eventually, because you know you're gonna just gotta be smart and doing a couple of things. Remember one thing: if you create an IP, and I think this has been followed by everybody else globally, which every other IP that I've seen internationally. Pardon me for using the word, but brands tend to bastardize your festival. Okay. Don't let them do it. Just hold your ground and tell them, if you're not going to pay, doesn't matter. But this is the only way you're going to be presenting your brand. It's going to be more experiential. Don't make a brand, don't make the audience hate the brand that's being part of the experience. You know, don't put trans lights and backlits and spoil it and let them hijack your IP. Let the vibe be. They will listen to you. If they see value in your proposition, if they see long-term benefit in what they're going to be part of, they'll start appreciating it. Hold your ground, and we've seen a tremendous success in just the previous edition, the first ever edition, but it was just organic. Everything fit in perfectly. And I don't know if I have the time to take you through the exact examples of how we managed to do that, but that's what we should do.
So that's the view of a creative person. Now, Varun, let me ask you. You belong to a large corporate, and you work for large corporates. How do large corporates look at kickstarting IPs that they currently own or they probably sponsor or become a partner to? Do they think it the same way or any other way?
To a large extent, same way. The idea needs to be big. It needs to be scalable. It needs to reach out to my core audience. It adds to the bottom line too, because I'm wearing that hat. But more important is that why are you doing a particular IP? What is the gain in it? Is it a society in large also? Is it only money? Is it mix of both? For me, PWL is a classic example where we got the international wrestlers to come and compete with our guys, so much so that Sakshi won medal and she applauded our PWL. So that in society as large, we did a great job. At the same time, the franchises were very happy with the kind of money they were raking in. At the end of the day, it is happiness for everybody. But if you are not able to scale an IP, then trust me, the heart will die in another 2 years.
So Varun, this is what happened, right?
Yeah.
But before it happened, and before hands and legs and minds went into actually creating it, the nuts and bolts, what happened before? What was the process?
See, I tell you, it all started. We run a very successful media company with India News, with 4 regional channels, with NewsX. Our regional sphere in the areas where wrestling is very popular is anyways there with my Haryana, UP, MP. So the idea was very strong, no doubt about it. Idea backed by research is the most key area, that the idea was strong. But because beyond cricket, the only thing which was giving you a lot of hope was wrestling at one point of time when it comes to an Asian or an Olympic arena, right? Now, how can we make it big? Because when we plan in the corporate circle, we don't talk of a year or two. We talk of 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, and how do we turn it around, right? But if the scalability is not there, Manish, then trust me, no IP will survive beyond the business.
So exactly. So how do you find scalability? Is it that's exactly the point that I want to really dig deep into.
See, scalability basically comes from two angles. One, of course, if I'm talking of a sport or any event, what is the viewership? Like what Sabas said, applause. What is the kind of people you can rope in? What is the passion level to it? Can we scale it up to a large extent? If we are able to scale it up, what is the kind of resources we require, right? Is it a saleable thought or not? So there are a whole lot of things involved, because at the end of the day, money is equally important for it to grow. The sport will not grow without money. Like a normal small wrestler from a small town in a PWL might get 10 lakhs or 20 lakhs for just wrestling for 8 or 9 days. And that too, I'm talking of an amateur wrestler. So I'm saying you have to make prosperity for all, but the more important thing is whether that idea will be likable to the viewers or to a large audience. Because for me, while of course I do it on ground, majority sports are TV sports now. You know?
Okay.
So the television has to look beyond and make it more bigger.
So let me throw something at all of you, and then Shoven, I have a specific question at you later. But when at Alchemist, one of the processes that we follow to create any IP whatsoever, and we have created successful, not so successful, and waiting to be successful, all kinds of IPs. But one of the things that we do is make sure that on paper, at a conservative level of finding, it at least breaks even the first very year. Good idea, bad idea, very bad idea, very good idea. Where is it?
Good idea.
Good idea.
At least on paper, it's got to, you've got to break even. You've got to look at it more practically.
Okay.
And know what you're hedging at, you know. If you go with that approach, you'll most often than not end up delighting yourself.
Got it. Shoven, what's your idea?
I mean, of course, it's a very good idea to break even in year one of your IP, but it's very difficult as well. It also really depends on what your business plan is and what the scale of the event or the festival is. It also depends on if someone is buying into your thought and if someone is backing you up in terms of brands and stuff.
But what if an idea is not breaking even? Will you trash it or will you rejig it, or will you just go with it if you know that long term?
For me, if you ask me, I mean, first and the only IP we've done is Enchanted Valley Carnival. Now we've done a couple of more IPs as well, but it was a very risky IP and there was no way we could break even, so it was a big risk for us.
Okay, yeah. Great. Varun, your view?
It's a good idea, but at the same time, first year, second year, it is breaking or not is not my contention. As an organization, we look at how much we can scale it up and how long that idea can sustain. Because it's not about an year or two, because first year, if you cut corners, then you're not being able to make a great brand. So it is all about making a brand bigger, bigger, bigger year on year, then only scalability will come.
Shoven, you've created a great music IP, right? A festival, EVC. A question that I've had for many years now, and thanks to the great guys here, I've got the opportunity to ask you and the others. Isn't there too much happening in the music space, first point one? Point two, what is this great thing about fascination of events with youth? I mean, most events are music-based, and most of those music-based events are extremely centered around youth, under 30, whereas the money is outside. The money is outside 30-plus, right? And 35-plus, maybe. But most IPs in music are being created there. So what's happening out there?
Going back to your first question, when we started in 2013, back then, of course, there were many concerts happening, but there were not many festivals. There was NH7 happening as well, so I think it was in the year two. There was Sunburn, who was in the year five or six. And we started in 2013, and at the same time, a festival called Supersonic by Viacom was also started.
Correct.
So there were, like, I think there were four big festivals happening, and then a couple of smaller festivals. Today, in like this year, 2017, I think in December itself, there are about 7 to 8 big festivals. There is a big event happening every week. There's a big concert happening every week. There's Ed Sheeran happening.
There are about 94 music IPs in the country today.
Okay, I didn't know there were so many.
Yeah, there are.
But yeah, I mean, in terms of big music festivals, there are, I think, about 10 or 15, and there are about 20 or 30 big concerts happening in the country. I honestly feel everyone is getting into this business. It's not that easy a business. It is very important where you do it, how you do it, which artists you're getting down, what is your marketing plan. It cannot be done in a hurry. It has to be planned well in advance. Audience is very limited. Everyone is getting into the electronic space. I don't think the audience for electronic music is growing at the rate the number of events are happening in this country. So it is very risky. But now a lot of Bollywood IPs as well are coming up. Music is a very vast genre, but I honestly feel, if you ask me my honest opinion, I think it's a very competitive market.
It is.
Yes, very.
Right? And therefore, maybe there's a thought required for people who get into this market once again, because the audience is the same, especially the core audience, right? And they travel with the music.
It depends on the kind of music. Also, another big challenge of a festival is in India, I don't see a lot of people traveling for festivals. If you're doing a festival in Mumbai, it's the Mumbai audience that are again. If it's Pune, it's Pune. Of course, apart from Goa, which is a destination, and we do it in a destination, Amby Valley, 70-80% of our audience is traveling. So that's a challenge we have in getting people to Amby Valley.
Sure.
But we've been successfully doing it from 800 people to 15,000 people in year four. But it's a challenge because that's people usually think if you go for a concert in Bombay, it's 4,000 rupees. But if you go to Amby Valley, EVC is about 15,000-20,000 rupees. So that's an expense. It's an entire weekend which you have to give of your year, which is, so I mean, yeah, that's a challenge. I'm sorry, I didn't get your second question.
No, my question was just this, what is this about fixation with music and specifically with youth as an audience?
I think it's not every festival is targeting youth. It depends on the genre of music. If you are into electronic music, you are targeting youth, because I don't think anyone of 30, 35 plus is just listening to electronic artists like Martin Garrix, etc. But if you're doing a Bollywood IP, if you're doing, for example, I think NH7 Weekender gets youth as well. It gets an elderly audience as well. We also have 20-30% audience is more than 40. So,
but largely the center point is somebody below 30. Yeah. Somebody who's there to chill out.
I think it's 13 to 20.
Sorry?
13 to 20.
30 to 20, the other way around. Okay, great. Yeah. Let me ask the question, same question, but the other way around. Do you think there is scope outside which could probably get better revenues if you were to look at it in a very, very straightaway, non-hard fashion? If you were to set out to create an IP today, then it's better to stay out of music, stay out of youth, and create something for the, if I may call them elderly, including at least me.
You know, India has an insatiable need for beautiful experiences, all right? Right? It could be across gourmet, it could be across music, it could be across fashion, sports, you name it, what have you. And, you know, so there is an opportunity for us to, just the way a lot of other, like for instance, when one of my colleagues said, stay away from cricket and do something much more, there is a huge opportunity to do things beyond just music. Secondly, there is an opportunity to create high ticket value events, experiences. Music, incidentally, is a part of a festival. Every festival has to have music in it in any case. So if you stay true to a few simple things, right? I know that you haven't asked this question, but I think it's really important for people who are creating large format IPs to understand these four things. If you do these four things right, you will keep getting your audiences to come back to you no matter what you create, right? One, of course, the essence of the, you know, whatever you're trying to create, whether it's food or whatever. But when we do events for about, say, between 80,000 people and 2 lakh people, when you do large format events, what's really important is your personal experience. You know, as a girl or as your girlfriend or your wife and yourself, if you have decent sanitation, for starters, I mean, if you have 80,000 people, have you made a plan and paid that money, not just for a big artist, but to make sure that you have the right experience for them as far as toilets are concerned, number one, water, food, garbage management. You take care of these four things and feed them anything else, they'll buy it, they'll consume it, they'll come back to you. You know, as long as you make the experience fantastic, knowing that our country doesn't have very good infrastructure anywhere, you're starting from the ground up, you take care of these four things, you have people who come back to you constantly and curated in a way that's so brilliant, you can sell them anything.
Okay.
It could be, you know, so that's what it is. And of course, to answer your question, there's an opportunity to do much more than just this. And you don't have to always stick to the 20 to 30 bracket. I think there's a lot more money in beyond that, because people are more discerning. You can create boutique festivals, smaller but very high value, great experience festivals, and you make more money out of that. Yeah.
Varun, let me ask you a very different question. There was a time when television revenues were far more driven by advertising rather than subscription, right? Now it's changing. Events, I have noticed in India in particular, don't run on ticketed money or haven't run on ticketed money by and large. The first one I remember and recall, and correct me if I'm wrong, was something that I haven't perceived was created, which was Sunburn, which made money out of ticketing. Otherwise, most people want them free, or most people want to go complimentary, right? And this doesn't just include the police and the administration, but others as well. Do you believe that we have come of age and are now ready to make IPs which make sense on paper and otherwise based on ticketed revenues only?
Yeah, it all depends on what the idea is. From my side, from the television that I work on or a network, we do all the events which has a lot of TV magnifying power, because that's my core strength.
Sure.
But now, of late, the kind of proposals we get from a lot of guys who want to come, associate with us, there is a lot of scope that on-ground revenues with all the advertising and everything can supplement and make that event much more profitable. They just need TV to amplify it.
So let's quickly move from the kick-starting part to fueling an IP. And there are a few questions that come to my mind, and I'll randomly probably ask you all those questions. When it comes to scalability, which you talked about, Varun, right? You talked at least thrice about scalability. I have a question. The moment I hear scalability in today's world, or forget today's world, in 2000 world ever, I always think of digital, because those are the questions typically VCs ask you when you take them any idea, and they ask you, is it scalable? And what it actually means does it have a digital leg? So are digital legs very important to create or create later once an IP is successful?
No, digital is equally important. Because you really don't know where your viewer is sitting at the end of the day. You really don't know how fast the idea can be scalable. Because at the end of the day, event is as successful as it's being talked about. Money is one side, but
so my question is, suppose we create an event which is only for 1,000 people and it consistently caters to only 1,000 people. Is it not considered scalable in that case, or is not considered a great IP?
It can be scalable, but at the end of the day, the idea needs to be powerful enough to take it on to a next level. I'll give you an example to explain a point. I'll again take wrestling, because I'm deeply entrenched the last 2 years into wrestling. And we used to only do that 6 teams, all the wrestlers all around the world, 20 gold medalists fighting together in a team sport. Today, in Haryana, I'm doing a different dangal. In Maharashtra, I'll do a different dangal. In places, I'll do a different dangal. They themselves have much more scalability than we thought. So ultimately, what appeals to a large audience of an idea that you are creating will then make it successful. So money will follow later. First, the idea has to appeal to the large audience.
So Shoven, what does it take for an IP to then diversify? If I was to ask you, if you were to take EDC on a diversification mode, or let's say a scalability mode, there was a time when Sunburn created Sunburn Arena, and there are others who created smaller tentacles of the same thing, right? Going to colleges, etc. What is this about? How do you fuel, how do you grow an IP, and when do you do it? What's the right time to diversify?
Yeah, so we are in a year 5. This is the year when we've also got into colleges, clubs. We have a property called EV365, which is for clubs. Yeah, it's for colleges. We're doing smaller or bigger concerts as well next year. So I think the timing is very important. At a time when your brand is a bit established, where people know of the brand, is when you can go to colleges and clubs, because you don't want to take your brand to a club which is outside of the state, or you know, other part of the country where people don't know you and people don't come for the brand. So I think the timing is really important. There is this model which people follow in festivals. I mean, it's followed by Sunburn, Supersonicas, everyone, is that you do a festival, then you do a concert, and then you do arenas, and then you do clubs and colleges. So I mean, this is the trend which everyone is following currently, because I think in India, people are not able to sell 25,000, 30,000 tickets for a festival is when they start breaking up the festivals into arenas and club shows and college shows.
Is that the right strategy at all?
That is a strategy which is working at the moment from a business point of view. So that is a strategy which everyone is following. I don't think that is a correct strategy. Ideally, a festival should be able to sell 30, 35,000 tickets and earn money without getting brands on board. You should not really bank on your sponsors, you know, to kind of break even. But sponsor should be a profit. That's how a business should be done. But unfortunately, it's not the scenario in India at the moment. So this is what the brands want, and this is what the festivals have to kind of curate it for the brand.
So you talked about let the brand not bastardize the event. Interesting point at that. Shall we take it as brands are actually helping events to stand on their own feet faster? And therefore, if you mix it with this point of when is the right time to diversify, do you decide that with the sponsoring brands? What takes for us to look at diversification agenda of a set IP? On what's the right time?
Okay, it's very important for you to have a great relationship with the brand that you're working with, and they will not bastardize if they start respecting the reason why you're asking them not to bastardize it. And they see results in the manner in which you integrate the brand, right? And they trust you with their brand, and they start sort of, you grow together. And then they say, listen, we can now spend more, we can go to more cities, we can do much more. So can we scale the whole thing up again? Scale could be multiple the same event happening in multiple cities, or another one could be scale the experience, not necessarily the number of people. And of course, like you previously asked, digital is quintessential. It's sort of, there's no two ways about it. With the kind of monies that one has to spend on above the line, that's the best way to sort of reach out, create a community. But brands understand that really well, and Therefore, you can grow. And there's no set strategy to say when you need to make it grow. When do you go bigger or when do you diversify? It happens as you grow with the brand. And fortunately for us, for the last 22 years, we've been working with brands. My oldest brand that I'm working with is now for the last 18 years. They trust us with what we say and what we do. They are okay with us failing once in a way if we have to. But they know you mean the best. And if you have that privilege, you can't go wrong. And there are many other brands who are going to come back to you. And therefore, it's a success story, right? That's how it is.
So if I was to corner you three gentlemen, say, tell me a time or a time zone where you should look at diversifying, changing gears, changing the very construct of your IP. And I'm not just necessarily talking music IPs, any IP. What should that period be? Any guesses at that? I know it's a difficult question because it's...
I believe that the brand that we handle, every year we have to come out with something new.
Okay.
Every year. I'm sorry. Year on year we are trying different things. Because you have to, there's a core audience that you have to add audiences around you.
Okay.
You have to make it more bigger. You make it more bigger, of course, the guys who are supporting you will also get bigger. So ultimately, you have to look at them also. So it's a twin sword that is hanging on you.
Okay.
So for us, it's an every year phenomenon. We have to do something new.
What about you?
I agree. You really have to do something different every year, add something to your festival or your IP every year, because if you want your audience to, I mean, there is a loyalty towards an IP. And that's the reason there is something like Early Bird, which we sell for our IPs. But if I were to go to a festival for 3 years and I would see the same stages or the same experience or everything exactly the same, I would probably want to venture and try out a new IP as well. So your experience has to grow. I need to feel better every time I go to the same place. I need to have a better experience or a different experience when I come back to the brand.
If that is the case, do you also agree?
I completely agree.
You do? So here's a question that I have, and I'm sorry it'll come like a stump, but look at Tomorrowland, look at Rio Carnival, look at Woodstock. They haven't purposely or wanting to innovate, they haven't innovated. They haven't. They've remained largely true to the grain. And they've been successful. So how does that work?
Because they do it right all the time. They keep the basics in place.
So does it mean that innovation every year means that we haven't got it right the first time?
Can you repeat
that? Does it mean that if we are emphasizing on changing or innovating every year, that means we haven't got it right in the first time?
You've got it right. You're improvising, you're staying relevant with the needs. You are constantly looking out, you're doing your research, you know who you're talking to, you know how to get more audiences, you know how those people should experience the same. If I'm going to go back fifth time to Tomorrowland, what the hell, why should I come back the next year again? What's the one thing that's dragging me back again? It's because there is a new experience every time that they create. They wow you, you're completely blown away with the new innovative, not just the artist, but the whole experience. So similarly, as I say, it's a case with this another festival called Secret Garden Festival that happens in the UK in Huntingdon. I mean, every year they simply blow your mind with some innovation, which you want to come and experience year after year again. So you have to stay relevant. You got to delight them constantly. And you can do the two simple things right. You'll get the audiences coming back all the time.
Okay, let me change the gear once again. And a very different question this time, gentlemen. More to do with legalities. So I believe India is one of the lesser countries when it comes to IPs, authorization of them, as well as their protection. I'm assuming that you'll believe that I'm right at that. Now, in a country like this, where the protection of an IP is extremely impossible, what does an IP really mean? Is it just a fancy word of an event which repeats every year, which somebody else can very simply copy and do and you can do nothing? So I'm not saying who's right or wrong, but Sunburn happened and then Supersonic happened, right? Very similar. What does an IP therefore mean in this circumstance where in India you just can't protect it unless you think differently? Varun, I'll start with you.
I think we need to differentiate and innovate every now and then. There is no hard and fast answer that I can give you on this.
Okay.
But you have to be differentiating, you have to be thinking out of the box. The viewer or the audience outside is very smart. If they connect with you, they connect with you like anything. That is why you see some events doing very well and the copy people who copy it are not doing as well.
So let me ask a simple question. In television, it's not an event, but in television, news at 9, happens to be a very, very common. Obviously, you have different names, but everybody has a news at 9, isn't it?
Not really.
No?
When everybody is at news at 9, India News has super fast news. So that's the
difference. That was a good plug-in. What do you say?
No, I think it's still in its nascent stage in terms of, you know, containing and protecting your copyrights. If it's a live space which is not televisable, you know, a property which is not going to be, as long as it's digital, then it's fairly robust. You've got fairly robust laws and so on where people cannot really copy and take it away from you. But if it's a live, like for instance, we're saying Sunburn, it's not a televised event, is it? It's just a live experience. Yeah. That can be, there is no way to measure and say you've taken this away from me or that away from you. As long as it's just a live experience, it's the vibe. You can create a format, and if you're able to drive people to come to you instead of going to another one on the same date and the same thing, then the other person is doing something right to make sure that they've curated it better. So therefore, by merely doing that, you're being unique. So you're not copying anything away.
Okay.
On the other hand, if it's going to be a sports event or if it's an IFA that's being telecast, you know, then you know things are pretty robust and you have laws that sort of keep you safer, is what I think.
I'll just take one thing. In television, there are a lot of music IPs which run across channels.
Yeah.
And majority of them are almost similar.
Yeah.
But still, one or two will be such which you would be keen to watch again and again and again.
Yeah.
And they will be more bigger than that because they have been differentiating, innovating, and they're striking in the audience mind and heart.
Actually, Varun, good you talked about TV. In TV in particular, especially the international ones, they are well differentiated. So you won't confuse an Indian Idol with something else, right? I mean, a Fremantle will have a very differentiated policy versus BBC doing something on this. Why don't we have that at the event scale as well? Or is it just not possible given Indian laws? Shoven, you would like to take that one?
No, could you? Yeah.
So I'm saying when it comes to international ones, obviously they're protected by international rules.
Yeah.
And therefore, an Indian Idol is Indian Idol. I mean, you can't come close to it, right?
Right.
You'll be sued for millions.
Sure.
In India, that doesn't happen. Is there any way we could protect our IPs in events and think of it today so that maybe 5 years from now, our successors will at least get some benefit of that?
I guess it's time for us to start that process. Sorry, I took that away, but then it's the right time. I mean, for one to at least begin to try and find
And what do you do in that? Any
we have
ideas?
To just wait and watch, honestly, for us. We are so focused on trying to get things done and get the math right. We haven't really thought, I mean, haven't really focused too much on these things for people not to copy, honestly. So, yeah, I guess I don't have an answer to that, honestly.
Okay, Shoven, you have a thought?
I think for a festival, for an event, it's impossible. There's always someone who's going to copy you. Because what we're doing is we're doing production, we're doing music, we're doing. We were the first people to start camping, and I think a lot of festivals have tried doing camping. But I think whatever you do it right, you create the right vibe. Then even if people try to copy you, it doesn't matter because you're always better than the others. So I think that's what's really important in an IP. And I, for festivals, I don't think you can stop anyone from copying you. I mean, whatever we did was also a festival. Technically, Sunburn was the first festival to start off. They had a beautiful city, which was Goa. They moved from Goa to Pune. There's a new festival happening in Goa now. So there's going to be people who are coming, copying. But I think you just got to be a little above your competitor.
So it's more in the execution now, the game, as of now, right? And it'll remain so in your mind.
Yes.
Okay, great. So let me, I don't know whether we've overshot our time, but I believe that I normally do overshoot my time. So I'll ask one last question before we open it to the people. If we were not to name our own IPs, your own IP, you don't name, which do you think is the best Indian IP? And tell me why, in your mind. Oum, we'll begin with you.
IFA.
IFA?
Yeah.
Brilliant. And why is that?
The most scalable. They've demonstrated it by sustaining it, scaling it, sustaining, scaling, and marketing it consistently.
And diversifying as well.
I beg your pardon?
And diversifying as well, by that logic.
Yeah.
They've done a lot of new things to IFA.
Absolutely. And they stayed through the most difficult times and everything. Today, the world is bidding for IFA to go into. Which other property in the country has that kind of a platform where the world is bidding for your property to come to them?
So actually, it takes, what I hear is it takes a cricket or a movie or a Bollywood thing to actually make it that big, isn't it, in this country?
I guess so. I mean, I don't know if that is a real reason. I think the way they've managed to curate it, there are many other Me Toos who've also tried to do the same thing internationally.
Okay.
But they have not been as successful as an IFA. There are other international film awards that have also happened.
So
but
IFA
not been
it is for Oum. Shoven,
yeah.
Your?
I mean, for the music space, I think Weekender has done a good job when it comes to Weekender has done a good job when it comes to creating and sustaining an IP. I don't think they overspend. I don't think they're very careful with the spends and stuff. But still, they get a good audience. The vibe is really good. So I mean, that's one festival which I look up to. If you know, I want to sustain in the long run. You know, I mean, we are completely different from them. We are very different, but I think it's a brilliant IP.
That's very brave of you to have said it about a competitor. Great, fantastic. Thank you so much. What do you say, Varun?
For me, of course, it will be Pro Wrestling League because that's one thing which is creating a lot of differentiation. We are going to scale it up to different countries now. So hopefully,
so something that is not yours.
IFA will be hands down. I have not seen a better product into the television space also, and the way they have got countries and people residing from the Indian origin back to the roots. That's a phenomenal successful story.
Interesting. Thank you, gentlemen.
Because even if you take an IPL, it's only the cricketing nation that will bid for you. IFA, the world is your plate.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
So the potential, the commercials, the viewership, the brand integration to everything, it sort of scales right on top on every count, unlike any other.
Respect that. Yeah. Great. So we've had a great session out here. Thanks, Varun. Thanks, Shoven.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.